Hello students, good morning to everyone. So today I hope my topic will be interesting for you. And the topic I'm going to take is today is about spinal and epidural anesthesia. I hope you'll be enlightened with some basic history. So you know what is spinal anesthesia, no? So something you're going to give in the vertebral column. You're going to check the vertebral column, check the spinal cord, and you're going to give drug in that area. So that once you're giving the drug in that area, it is going to cause loss of sensation and motor loss will be there below the umbilicus. So the surgeons will be easy to perform the surgery. So that is why we want to give spinal anesthesia. So before going into the depth of spinal anesthesia, I will briefly like to give a brief discussion about the history of spinal anesthesia. So what is spinal anesthesia? Who discovered? Yes, it was August Baird. He discovered in 1898. So that is the introduction of spinal anesthesia. And next it is about caudal anesthesia. What is caudal anesthesia? So some drug which you are giving in the caudal space. So caudal space is the lowermost portion in the spinal region, isn't it? So near the lumbar region, you will have the caudal region. So there we are going to give anesthesia. So that was introduced in the year 1901 by Kathleen. And next thing, you have a lumbar epidural anesthesia, that is epidural anesthesia. Instead of spinal anesthesia, we can also give epidural anesthesia. What is this? In spinal anesthesia, we are going to give the drug in the subarachnoid space. So the drug will go and mix with the CSF and start acting. Whereas in your epidural anesthesia, the drug is mainly given in the epidural space. So this is called as epidural anesthesia, and that one is called as spinal anesthesia. So epidural anesthesia was first discovered in 1921 by Pages. And what is this you see? No, you're seeing something like one needle, Tohi needle. So what is that needle? That is nothing but your epidural needle. So this Tohi needle is an epidural needle where we are going to give epidural anesthesia. And this was discovered in the year 1945. Okay, so this thing, I know you'll be knowing about this anatomy. So it is a vertebral column, the membranes, the spinal cord, everything. So see, look at the curvatures. You have the cervical vertebra, thoracic vertebra, lumbar vertebra, sacrum, and the coccyx. So our aim to give anesthesia, spinal anesthesia, will be mainly mostly in the lumbar vertebra. So thoracicist is more concerned about the lumbar vertebra. So lumbar vertebra, how many vertebra are there? So you have L1, L2, L3, L4, and L5. So the anesthesia is going to be given in the lumbar region. So before going to the anesthesia, you should now have a brief idea about the anatomy. So the vertebral column, then what is the membranes? Membranes surrounding the spinal cord. It will be dura mater, arachnoid, and the pia mater. And see this vertebral column, each vertebra will be having ligaments. Supraspinous, interspinous, ligamentum flavum. Now, this ligamentum flavum is the most important ligament, because once we enter into the ligamentum flavum, we'll have a loss of resistance, and then we will know we'll be into the subarachnoid space. So you should know what are all the ligaments through which the needle is piercing. So first is the supraspinatus, interspinous rib, and then the ligamentum flavum. So next is, this is the anatomy. See, you can see, you know, the intervertebral disc, the intervertebral foramen, the spinous process, vertebral body, all the structures can be seen. And see this, the curvatures of the vertebral column. See, can you see the curvatures? So this is the curvature of the vertebral column. See how the fetus is appearing, the newborn at 4 years, what is the changes? And at an adult, you have the changes. So the primary curvatures will be in the thoracic region and the sacral region, and the secondary curvature will be in the cervical and the lumbar region. So this is a brief discussion of the curvatures. And see this, how the curvature is going to be useful for our spinal anesthesia. Can you see the highest point at third lumbar vertebra is the highest point, and the lowest point of thoracic is the fifth thoracic vertebra. So why this we are giving importance is the drug which you are going to give in the lumbar region will be within this space. So it will not go up and ascend to the thoracic region, and neither it will come travel to the sacral region. It will be constrained within the lumbar region. That is why we are more bothered about the curves. So this is how the curves will be predicted. And see, this is the spaces. You have the ligamentum flavum, epidural space, the cerebrospinal fluid. All this has been a pictorial representation. Can you see? All this is there. So you have the blood vessels, connective tissue, fat, and these are spinal nerve roots are there. So briefly, where does the cord ends in the adult is at L1. So the ending of the spinal cord is ending at L1. So we should be knowing it. Because why it is important for the anesthetist is, once the cord ends at L1 level, you can give spinal anesthesia below this level. That is, the spinal cord will not be damaged by your technique. So that we select the place between L2, L3, L4 and L5. So anywhere between these space, you can give spinal anesthesia. And see the spinal needle. Can you see the spinal needle entering? So one needle is entering into the subarachnoid space and the other needle is, see, it is entering into the epidural space. And the morphology variation, cervical level, thoracic level and lumbar level. So now, how are you going to locate how to give spinal anesthesia? This is a small surface anatomy. So when you're making the patient sit, you ask the patient to sit, you're going to paint that region and you're going to locate the space. So how are they going to locate, whether it is between L2 or L3 or L3 or L4 or L4 or L5, how are we going to locate? So what you're going to do, you first select the highest point of iliac crest. So both the right side and left side, you select the highest point of iliac crest. And then what you're going to do is, you're going to draw a line between these two iliac crests. So once you draw the line, that line will cross the fourth lumbar vertebra. So this is the point, okay. So now you will have an idea, okay, the line is at the fourth level, fourth lumbar vertebra. So above will be the third lumbar vertebra, below will be the fifth lumbar vertebra. So with this technique, we can able to identify the space. And next, this is the dermatome level. So when are you going to give the spinal anesthesia, the most important thing is at what dermatome level the drug is going to get blocked. So this, what is a dermatome? It is the area of skin innervated by a sensory fiber of a single spinal nerve. So roughly for the anesthetist, what we do is, we roughly take as T10. So T10, can you see, it is at the level of umbilicus. And T6 will be at the level of xiphoid. And T4 will be at the level of nipples. So whenever you give the drug, our aim, if it is going to be below umbilical surgery, means our aim is to keep the level just at T10 level. So you're given a spinal anesthesia and the dermatome level should be just around T10. Suppose you want more a higher level, like in cesarean section. If you want a higher level cesarean section, you need a higher level. So that will be up to T6. So T4 and all we use very rarely. So mainly T10 and T6 will be the level of anesthesia we are going to give. And this is again some common dermatome levels. So I already discussed about T4, T6 and T10. And if you want ankle, foot surgeries, lower limb surgeries, your level can be just L1 and L2. And for perineal and anal surgery, it is just a saddle block where it is going to block only the S2 to S5 segments. So this is a brief tabular column for the procedures, common surgical procedures, and what is the final dermatome levels. So this is again for the lower limb surgeries. Now for the upper abdominal surgery, you require a level of T6 to L1. And this catheter tip is mainly for your epidural anesthesia procedures, okay. So in epidural anesthesia, what we do is, we put the needle, we already saw no tohi needle. That needle will be inserted, we'll find the space, and then a catheter will be threaded into that needle and the catheter will be fixed. So here the catheter tip and the segmental levels is the tabular column. Okay, now how do we decide whether you need a spinal or epidural anesthesia? So you have to decide on the length of the procedure. Suppose the procedure is going to be a very short duration, spinal is enough. No need to go for epidural. Because epidural means you can go in for a longer procedures, more time. And need for prolonged post-op anesthesia. For this, you need an epidural. Because in spinal anesthesia, we're giving the drug. It will take around 45 minutes time, and with this we will get ended. But for epidural anesthesia, we need a prolonged post-op analgesia can be given under epidural anesthesia. So the catheter we have already placed. We are going to give the drug, and this can be even for 48 hours. You can keep this. And the next important factor is the comorbid illness. So you have to think whether the patient is having diabetic or hypertensive, and according to that, we have to decide whether we can give spinal or epidural. So now coming for the indications, where all you give spinal anesthesia, where all we want to give? Yes, we want to give for lower abdominal surgery, obstetric and gynecological surgery. What is the obstetric surgery? Your section, C-section, LSCS. What is the gynecological surgery? Like hysterectomy or vaginal hysterectomy, abdominal hysterectomy. All this will be needing your spinal anesthesia. Then any lower limb surgery, an orthopedic lower limb surgery, it could be a fracture, plate fixing, or can be some procedures in the joint, anything can be given under spinal anesthesia. The next is the perineal and rectal surgery. So what are all the perineal and rectal surgery, you know, like you have hemorrhoid, no? So hemorrhoidectomy can be done. So anything in the perineal region or rectal region, you can go in for your spinal anesthesia. And the next indication is you want to give a analgesia, post-op analgesia. This will be done under epidural analgesia. So you can go in for post-op or French chest. Labor analgesia also, you can put the epidural needle and keep it. And for chronic pain management also, you can give an epidural analgesia. So early we saw what are all it is indicated. So now we are going to see the contraindication of spinal anesthesia. So we have two types. One is absolute. Absolute means should not give. No. Relative means okay, you have to think back. So you have absolute as a patient refusal, patient may be uncooperative, or patient have severe hypovolemia or coagulopathy. There can be local infections at the site where you're going to give the injection, or you can have a raised intracranial tension. So whenever there is ICT is raised, you're not supposed to give spinal anesthesia because there'll be cerebral honing. Honing can occur. So you're not supposed to give whenever there is increased pressure within the brain. And what are all the relative contraindications? You have a neurological disease, chronic back pain. So if the back pain, if you're going to give spinal anesthesia, the patient is going to keep on complaining that I'm having back pain. It is because of my spinal anesthesia. So try to avoid spinal anesthesia in these patients. And again, whenever there is infection at the site of injection. And any unknown duration of the surgery, you don't know what is the duration of surgery. So if it's going to be a very prolonged surgery, no point in giving spinal anesthesia. So these are the contraindications of spinal anesthesia. So, okay. So what are the things, what are we going to disclose? Consent. How are you going to get a consent for spinal anesthesia? So before for any procedure you're going to go, you have to obtain a consent from the patient, asking the patient, telling the patient, this is the procedure I'm going to do. And are you willing to undergo this procedure? So all these things should be taken into consideration. So first thing you want to disclose is the failure. Yes, I can give spinal anesthesia. Maybe the spinal anesthesia may not be taken, and automatically I can convert the patient into general anesthesia. So that consent should be obtained first. The next is paresthesia. After giving spinal anesthesia, after the procedure is over, there might be some numbness in the lower limb. So this also should be explained to the patient, because after the surgery, the patient keep on telling, I'm not able to move my limbs. I'm having some numbness. So you should be able to explain the procedure complications of spinal anesthesia. Another important one is back pain. You have to explain about the back pain. See, not all cases will have back pain, but some patients do have back pain, and this should also be obtained in your consent. Okay, now what is this PDPH? This is postdural punctural headache. So what happens when we are giving a spinal anesthesia or an epidural anesthesia? You might accidentally puncture the dura, and there is going to be a lot of CSF draining, and because of the draining, there is going to be some alterations taking into the brain, and the patient will have severe headache. This headache will be mostly in the post-op period. So you have to explain to them that after the anesthesia, you may or may not have a headache. And last is your infection. At the site of giving injection, you get infected, but all these are least complications So however, whenever you're getting consent from the patient, you have to discuss all these points and get the consent. So this is the mechanism of neuraxial block. So what is the mechanism? Is the local anesthesia. What drug we are going to give? We are going to give bupivacaine injection. Bupivacaine 0.5% heavy. So why heavy means the density of this drug is higher than that of the CSF. So we are calling that as heavy. So this local anesthesia drug. So what are we are going to use? Bupivacaine. This is going to bind to the nerve tissue and this is going to block the nerve transmission, and that is the neuraxial blockade. And again, this is there going to be superficial and deep portion of the spinal cord and spinal nerve roots will be blocked. So again, you have a differential nerve blockade. This is just a brief thing you have to know, where you have a sympathetic blockade, motor blockade, and blockade of your small nerve fibers. So according to this blockade, you have the differential blockade can be done. So this is the differential nerve blockade. So the fastest and the slowest nerve fibers which is going to act. And another important thing is your what are the factors that is going to affect the local anesthetic distribution. So unless the drug acts distributed, an adequate anesthesia can be obtained. If it is not acting, the anesthesia will not be obtained. So what are all the important factors? Is the dose of the drug you give, the paracity of the drug, the what is the volume of CSF present, what is the age of the patient, the positioning of the patient, and the needle, what type of needle you use or what type of injection you give. So all this is important. Another important factor is the drug volume, the concentration of the drug, and what is the temperature of the drug, the viscosity of the drug. Again, another important thing is the weight and height of the patient and the spinal anatomy is also important. And lastly, we need the whether the injection is hypobaric. As earlier I taught you, hypobaric means the density of the drug will be lower than that of CSF. Hyperbaric will be more than that of CSF. And the needle type and the orifice, all these factors are going to take part in the factors affecting the distribution of the local anesthetic drug. And all this is the factors, as I said, no, hypobaric, hyperbaric, isobaric. And these are the less important factors. Now, what are the, we will mainly discuss on the technique. So the four P's, preparation, position, projection, and puncture. So you have to remember the four P's. That is how are you going to prepare the patient, how are you going to position the patient, and the projection, and finally, how are you going to puncture, at what site, at what level. So these will be discussed. So here you have the preparation. So you are going to give spinal anesthesia and you are going to do the preparation. What are you going to do? You are going to give a informed consent. Already I discussed. So you have to obtain the consent. Always do documentation. Then keep all the drugs ready. So epidural sets, your spinal needles, all your adequate drugs, pulse oximeter, NIBP, ECG should be connected. The spinal tray should be made ready. What are the things? See the picture. You can see the picture. What are all they have kept? They have kept some scissors, gauze, needles of different sizes, and sterile towel, spinal needle, everything, and the local drug. Everything should be arranged in the spinal tray. And see, these are the needle, different types of needle. You have Twinkies needle, Sprout, Whitcare, Green, all this. So the routine needle we use is a Twinkie Babcock's needle. So with this needle only, we are going to conduct the spinal anesthesia. And this is why you use a pencil or a cutting needle. Because if you're going to use a cutting needle, there's going to be more injury to the dura mater and more CSF leakage. If you're going to use a pencil pinpoint needle, this will have a less injury. So that is why we are showing the differentiation between a pencil pointed and a cutting needle. So now coming to the position. So what are the different types of position? So lateral position, lateral decubitus. This is the most popular and the patient comfort. And next is the sitting position. Sitting position, it will be, you have to make the patient sit, and this is especially in case of obesity and scoliosis. And also these patients, it's easy to identify the face. And here in sitting position, the hypotension will be more common in the sitting position. Another one is the prone position. So in the prone position, see in the picture, the patient is in the prone position and you have to give a spinal anesthesia in this position. So the position name is called as jackknife modification. And here mainly you use your hyperbaric drug. Don't use hyperbaric, only hyperbaric. And this position is mainly used for rectal and perineal surgery. So this is very rare we use. The main positions we use is the lateral position and the sitting position. Prone position we don't use mostly. And see the lateral position, how the structure is made. See the average patient lateral position ready for lumbar position. And the vertebral column is, see how it is horizontal too. And see the positioning. So this is the inclination you have to make in women and men. Next, you're coming to the, so we've seen the preparation, we've seen the positioning, and the third P will be your projection, and the fourth P will be your puncture. So whether you're going to choose, where are you going to choose your puncture? So where are you going to do? In the midline or paramedian? So usually we go in for the midline. So midline procedure is more common. Paramedian, why we use paramedian? Whenever you have a difficulty in the technique or there is calcification, especially in old age, the lumbar vertebral bone, everything, the ligaments, everything will get calcified in old age. So for those patients, paramedian approach is more common. Whereas in a normal patient, you can go in for a midline approach. So then you have a Taylor approach for L5 and S1 interspace. Usually in the umbilical pelvic procedures and neurological procedures, you can do this. So this are the major approach techniques. So this is the Taylor approach. And you have a midline approach and a paramedian approach. So briefly, I'll tell you what is the position of the needle and what is the pathway of the needle puncturing. So once you're introducing the needle into the spinal column, you're going to go in. First thing you pierce is the skin. So first will be the skin. The next layer you're going to feel is the subcutaneous fat. And the next third layer will be your supraspinous ligament, interspinous ligament. And finally, you'll be in the ligamentum flavum. Once you go into the ligamentum flavum, you'll have the loss of resistance. And finally, you'll go into the dura mater and enter into the subarachnoid space. So then in the subarachnoid space, you'll have the CSF where you're going to deposit the local anesthetic drug. And for the paramedian approach, everything is same, but a bit of difference is here you don't have the supraspinous and the interspinous ligament. Instead of that, you have a paraspinous muscle. Why this paramedial approach? Because this ligaments, like your supraspinous and interspinous ligament, will be calcified. So you go as a paramedian approach, or it is like a lateral approach. So what is the drug you want to take? So usually what we take is lignocaine. So lignocaine will be, we'll take the lignocaine and we can give the drug. This is the testing dose for epidural anesthesia. So coming for the spinal anesthesia, we are mainly giving bupivacaine, 0.5% bupivacaine heavy. It will be around, according to the procedure, we are going to give from 2 ml or 2.5 ml or 3 ml or 3.2 to 3.5 ml. We can give, so the maximum dose we can give is around 4 ml. Okay, next, we have given the drug. And what are the complications of spinal anesthesia? The immediate complication you are going to meet is the hypotension. So here you have a list of immediate complications which include hypotension, bradycardia, nausea, vomiting, shivering, pruritus. Then there can be some transient mild hearing impairment, failed spinal, total spinal anesthesia, and cardiovascular collapse. So the major complication we are going to anticipate is mainly your hypotension and bradycardia. And then what are the early complications? That is, early complications is in the post-operative ward. So after the post-operative surgery is done, in the post-operative period, what is the early complication? Early complication will be a urinary retention, PDPH, as I already mentioned, it is the post-dural functional headache and you have a back pain. And then late complications will be your trauma. Because of the needle injury, there can be an abscess, infection or meningitis. Sometimes you are going to pinch the spinal cord or there might be some abscess formation which can lead to ischemia of the spinal cord. Rarely you can get cauda equina syndrome, arachnoiditis, and peripheral nerve injury. So these complications are very rare, but we are mainly bothered about the immediate complications such as hypotension and bradycardia. So briefly I'll discuss what, so suppose you have given the anesthesia, spinal anesthesia, and the patient is having hypotension. So what do you mean by spinal hypotension? So the definition of spinal hypotension is whenever your systolic BP is decreased to less than 30% of your baseline value. Suppose your systolic BP is 120 millimeters of mercury. 30% fall means it is going to be less than 90 millimeters of mercury. So when it comes to 90 millimeters of mercury or below 90, you have to alert yourself that the patient is undergoing spinal hypotension and we have to immediately start our management. So this is the definition of spinal hypotension. So what are the things we are going to do? You have a non-pharmacological technique. So immediately you position the patient, see that the position is proper, give oxygen and leg compression. Why leg compression? Because in spinal hypotension, the cardiovascular return will be reduced. The return of the venous blood to the heart will be reduced. So that in order to increase your blood flow to the heart, we give leg compression. And then you can go in for your trundle and burp position. So this can also be done. And simultaneously, what you have to do is you have to push in the IV fluids, especially crystalloids. So crystalloids is very, very useful for correcting your spinal hypotension. And the pharmacological method, no, you have two main drugs. You have one is ephedrine and another is phenylephrine. So mostly we'll be using ephedrine, which is both an alpha and beta receptor agonist. And it is an excellent drug. So here what we do is we give ephedrine for almost all cases. The phenylephrine is more commonly used for C-section. So in antenatal cases, in cesarean section, the phenylephrine is found to be more advantage. So here we usually give ephedrine. So this ephedrine can be diluted and you can give the drug. Usually we give around 6 milligram, which will correct the hypotension. Okay, now the next complication we are going to find is the bradycardia. So what is the cause of bradycardia is there is blockade of the cardio accelerator fibers. What is going to block? The drug which we are given has ascended to T1 to T4 levels. Initially, I was telling the drug, we need the level up till T10 or T6. But sometimes what happens, accidentally, the drug goes and ascends up till T1, T4 level. And that time what happens, the patient will go in for bradycardia. So you have two important mechanisms. One is the Bainbridge reflex and the other is the Bessel-Jarisch reflex. So with these two reflexes, the bradycardia can occur. And how are you going to treat the bradycardia is, you're going to give atropine or ephedrine to treat the bradycardia. The next is important complication is your nausea and vomiting. So because of your spinal hypotension or sometimes some intrathecal additives will be had. Additives means in order to prolong the duration of action, we will add some morphine or clonidine or bupivacaine. Fentanyl, some drug will be added along with the bupivacaine. So that time patient can have nausea and vomiting. So these nausea and vomiting, how are you going to prevent this? You can give your ondansetron injection or ranitidine injection can be given for these patients. So you can also give glycopyrrolate in order to reduce your postoperative nausea and vomiting. So next important complications will be your failed spinal. So what is a failed spinal? Whenever there is no block, okay, the block may be insufficient or unilateral or patchy, or the duration may not be sufficient. That is a failed spinal. So another important complication is posterior functional headache. As I already mentioned, this will be occurring only after 24 to 48 hours, and sometimes it may appear within 7 days and usually disappears by 14 days. So mostly you have the headache comes whenever the patient is sitting upright. So whenever the patient sits, he will complain of lot of headache, throbbing headache, especially in the frontal and retroorbital region. Once he lies down, the headache disappears. So with this, you can identify, okay, the patient has got postural functional headache. So you can get alerted. So usually why you have this headache is because the CSF has been lost. There is a leakage with your spinal or epidural. Lot of CSF has been leaked out. So there is intracranial pressure changes are taking place. So as a result, you have headache. So the headache will be most least with a smaller gauge spinal needles. So that is why we are using now more of 25 gauge. Can you see the incidence is very, very low with your 25 gauge and 24 gauge and 27 gauge spinal needle. Whereas with your 22 and 23 gauge spinal needle, the incidence of postural functional headache is more. So management is, usually it is conservative because the headache will disappear. So conservative is ask them to take adequate bed rest and ask them to take adequate fluid. Lot of oral fluids can be taken. Suppose the patient is having vomiting, you can start an IV line. And you put a abdominal binder. This is for your venous return, improves the venous return. And suppose the headache is still not going, you can ask for some paracetamol or oral analgesics can be taken. And caffeine, what is the role of caffeine? Caffeine, potent vasodilator. So you can take caffeine tablet or whatever thing you have caffeine, you have a coffee. So a cup of coffee can also relieve your headache because coffee contains a lot of caffeine. So you can give a coffee also. And finally, if it does not work, all these above measures is not going to work, you go to give an epidural blood patch. So it is nothing but you draw around 15 to 20 ml of blood from the patient and you introduce into that epidural needle and it will get clotted and it will act as a patch. So this is the last step in the prevention of PDPH. So this is the ASRA guidelines recommended. What are the things should be used when you're going to give your spinal anesthesia, like mask wearing. You have to remove your bangles or your rings, whatever you're wearing. The thorough hand washing is important. Put a sterile surgical gloves, cap, and draping should be done. And you always use your chlorhexidine solutions as an antiseptic of choice. So the accuracy you can do is whenever you are not able to find with the anatomical landmarks because of obesity or scoliosis, always you can use an ultrasonograph. So with this, I am ending the topic of spinal anesthesia. I hope I have enlightened some few points in this. I hope it will be useful for you. Thank you.